It is World AIDS Day, and we're looking at how far we've come fighting the disease and what still needs to be done. For some, being infected with HIV is the only life they've known. Maluba Habanyama was born with HIV and has been managing the disease since she was a child. Welcome to you.
Thank you. Thank you for having me.
Tell me about your family history.
Yes. So my parents are originally from Zambia, Africa. I was born in London, England. But when my mother and father divorced, my mother brought me and my older sister to Canada. And in Ottawa, when I was 2 years old, they discovered that I was very sick. We assumed it was the Canadian winter. And then it was discovered that me and my mother were living with HIV, as well as my father. He had contracted it from an affair outside of his marriage. Gave it unknowingly to my mother. She unknowingly gave it to me through birth and breast milk.
That happens a lot.
Yes, that actually, yeah. I mean, now it's, you know, we've come so far where now a lot of HIV-positive mothers are having negative babies, but we cannot breastfeed. But there is a generation of us that are long-term survivors because we were born with HIV in the 90s.
Okay, so how has treatment for you changed over the years?
Oh, it's changed a big deal. I think when I was younger, I was taking about 5 pills twice a day, and I'm taking 3 pills once a day. It still can have the side effects. I'm also a woman living with HIV, which can be a whole different ballgame than men. So it has changed. It has advanced, but we still, of course, have a long way to go. But I'm very fortunate that I have great doctors and I've been a Canadian citizen for over 20 years. So I'm very fortunate to have that access to treatment that not a lot of people do.
How's it different for women than men?
It's, you know, women's bodies are just a whole different ballgame and different side effects, and has been proven in research that women's bodies can react different to medication than men dealing with. That can be with, you know, menopause, so many other things that the side effects can be different. And it's just, even just, I think the stigma that women can go through can be different than men.
In what way?
You know, I think for something that I've talked to a lot of women about is that I can't breastfeed. And in my culture, especially when you have a baby, they don't ask, how's the baby doing? They ask, how's the baby feeding? Mm. And that's something that's still heartbreaking to me that I'm going to have to deal with. I'm not going to have kids anytime soon, but it is heartbreaking that I'm not going to be able to have that bond with my child and breastfeed, or even have that choice to.
Mm-hmm. Okay. And do you find that there's still a stigma? Like, especially for you, you're a young woman,
yes,
right?
Yes, so, absolutely. Yeah. When I was about 7 years old, I had a mentor of mine that was grown up, and she made me eat off of paper plates and paper cups. So at 7 years old,
a mentor,
yes, it was like a big sister, big brother.
Oh,
yes.
Okay.
So it was like
even in the 90s.
Yes. Okay. Well, that was in 2000.
In the 2000s.
Yes.
Even
so
worse.
It was, yeah. So it was, as a child, I felt like I was more educated than adults in my life. I grew up very isolated. It was a big family secret. But you know, I have friends that have been turned away from dentists. I've been turned away from massage therapists. We still have officers out there that think HIV can be transmitted through saliva. So it's definitely, people are not educated, and there is still that stigma, which is heartbreaking to see, but I'm hoping to eradicate it. Mm-hmm. But it's important that, you know, Ron and I are able to come here and talk to you, but there's a whole other lot of people that are positive that are not able to be open about their status.
Yeah, and there's also the, you know, I spoke with an HIV specialist, mm-hmm, about the PrEP solutions,
yes,
that are available, mm-hmm, now for people as a prophylactic.
Yes.
But not everybody can access them in the country.
Yes, absolutely.
For price or for availability. I think they're available, but it's sometimes the doctors don't know about it.
Yes, exactly. The price is definitely, access to treatment is difficult. I know who's getting it is also a question. So, mm-hmm, it's great that it's there. Now we have that advancement, but of course, mm-hmm, we have a long way more to go and more advancements in getting access to everybody.
Okay, you were talking about just a second ago, and I diverted into the PrEP conversation, but you were talking about the stigma and how some people won't still believe that you can catch it through touching somebody, mm-hmm, or kissing somebody or what,
yeah,
have you. So tell me about what you and Ron participated in to smash that idea.
Yes, well, it was shown that 50% of Canadians would not want food prepared by an HIV-positive person, so we decided...
Oh, really? That's an actual stat?
Yes, that was
50%.
An actual stat.
Okay.
Yeah, Casey House did some statistics, and they actually found that, which is heartbreaking to know, so we decided to get 14 HIV-positive chefs, and we were trained. We got to make the menu and got to cook for over 100 people on 2 nights in Toronto. It was the first time done in the world, and it was amazing just to see that community come together and really see that support. But it also was something that when it went online the next day, there also were some negative comments, so it showed that the reason why we're doing it in the first place. But it was awesome. I don't cook. I can't cook, so it was a great experience to learn, at least. And now I know how to do 4 meals, at least.
Well, that's good.
Yes, exactly.
Maluba, thank you for coming in.
Thank you so
telling
much for
us your story.
Me. Thank
okay.
you.
Maluba Habanyama. Did I say that right?
Yes, Habanyama. I'm just going to go by Maluba, like
okay.
Madonna.
Maluba is a journalist living with HIV. Thank you for joining us.
Thank you so much.
We'll be right back. Take care.